no pointer? Okay. There is this. No, no, that's fine. That's fine. So I will discuss some aspects of string phenomenology. I will start with some comments on the related to the recent findings, the LHC, and the high string scale. Then we'll discuss also low string scale, extra U1s, and if I have time, the linear Dillard background. So the main question is if string theory is connected to the real world, then the main question is what is the value of the scale, which makes it determines where it is, how it is connected. This is an arbitrary parameter. We know now that it can be anywhere from the Planck scale to the TV, and there are physical motivations which favor some energy regions, essentially high TV related to the hierarchy, and intermediate scale could be related to supersymmetry breaking, strong CP, and so on. On the other hand, from the beyond the standard model physics, many it was during the last decades, it was mainly driven from the mass hierarchy problem, which I will hope that soon we will know if it was a correct way to think about. And the standard picture is low energy supersymmetry, which is realized in a natural way in string theory by going to the heterotic string, either the perturbative one or the non-perturbative version, M or F theory, since it provides a natural framework for unifying all the interactions with gravity at high scale. The main advantages of supersymmetry is that it introduces, of course, natural elementary scalars. It allows gauge coupling unification. It provides a candidate for dark matter and a mechanism, nice mechanism for the electroweak symmetry breaking. A main problem that it appears more and more severe is that its minimal, at least, version, the MSSM, appears to be already to fine-tuned. And this is how many people feel uncomfortable about starting feeling about low energy supersymmetry. On the other hand, we know that we have taken a small parenthesis. LHC works extremely well. So this luminosity plot, for instance, this year up to September, compared to how it was last year or the first one, which is almost zero compared to what is collected until now, we go to it goes to about 15 inverse femtobarn, and by the end of the year, if it runs as it goes now, it is expected to collect about double from this, 30 inverse femtobarn. And the main, of course, highlight is the discovery of a new particle, which is a boson, which is very, very. It seems to be the standard model Higgs boson, and in both experiments they have succeeded the minimum significance to claim a discovery. So, as I said, this Higgs-like discovery around 125 GeV is consistent with expectation from precision test to the standard model. Actually, it's something that one could expect from the precision tests that were already known some time ago. So it's compatible with this. And the second conclusion in my mind is that it favors perturbative physics, since the quartic coupling is of the Higgs is very small, it's about 1/8. It is the simplest phi to the 4 theory that we teach in in regards with the field theory course, the toy example, and it seems to be, it is only, it took 40 years to be realized, actually, to discover that it is realized in nature. On the other hand, if it is confirmed, the supersymmetry becomes fine-tuned, severely fine-tuned in its minimal version. But on one hand, it's too early, I think, to draw a general conclusion before the second run of the LHC. On the other hand, going a bit beyond the minimal version, for instance, by adding a singlet or by abandon the universality of S-quark of scalar masses and introducing split in the families, one can easily remediate the fine-tuning. And finally, also even experimentally, very little of the data have been analyzed in detail until now. And one expects next year to be still there is a room next year when you, then when they will analyze all the data of this year to have some already some signal. And the last important point is that one has to measure very important the properties of this particle, in particular the spin and the parity, for instance, is pseudoscalar or scalar. If it has spin 0 or spin 2, it cannot have spin 1 since it decays into photons. And this is expected to be done with inverse, with 30 inverse femtobarn with a precision of about 3 sigma. And moreover, it is important to measure the decay rates since any deviation of its couplings, for instance, to top, bottom, or the electroweak gauge bosons, will imply that there are new states that are involved in the electroweak symmetry breaking, and, this can alter the fine tuning. Right now, of course, everything seems to be okay. There are, of course, some, the precision is not yet much, but in general, there is an agreement with standard model Higgs expectation at 1.5 sigma. So it smells very much that it is the single standard model Higgs boson. On the other hand, as I mentioned, okay, for the moment, there is no education for physics beyond a standard model, and the bounds arrive at the TV level, so that's for supersymmetry, this is TV, so that's the only thing that you can see in this plot. And even other testing other theories, the unit becomes almost TV. So before proceeding, one of the legitimate questions that one can ask at the present situation is if, for instance, what could be wrong if the standard model is valid up to very high energies. And the Higgs sector brings a new coupling, the quartic coupling. So people have studied the evolution of this coupling at high energies, the same time that you do, that one does with the Gates couplings. And it appears that, first of all, this quartic coupling decreases and it goes to zero and then becomes negative at some energies. This computation was done in the past by several people, and there was a an idea which was put forward by Sapoznikov and Vetteri that based on asymptotic safety that the Higgs coupling could be almost zero at the Planck scale. But at that time, the mass of the top was around 171 GeV. And therefore, they made a prediction that for the mass of the Higgs, 125 based on this on this boundary condition. Today, the mass of the top became was increased, and one sees that this computation becomes very sensitive to the mass to the mass of the top. The reason is that the coupling there that it vanishes, of course, the leading correction has to go to two loop to find the results, because it's, the leading contribution is vanishing. And with the present value of the mass of the top and the strong coupling, the vanishing is, arises around the intermediate scale, 10 to the 11 GeV. So this means that there is an instability of the Higgs potential. Actually, it's not an instability, but it's metastable. So that means that there is another electrolytic vacuum in this region, which is much below, and could mean something. I mean, could mean if it is really there, because of course there are many ambiguities for the moment. It could signal that there is some there is something there, and it doesn't cannot know. One possible explanation is that there is new physics at this intermediate scale, which could be the next scale of new physics. In principle, of course, this would imply to drop the hierarchy problem. In principle, nothing can go wrong. I mean, dark matter, you can ask the question, what about dark matter? This could be an axiom, which... Of course, if you take supersymmetry, then there's no, if it is low energy supersymmetry, this computation is not valid anymore, and the vacuum becomes stable. I will show also with supersymmetry how it is. And also, I mean, I don't think personally should take it for the moment seriously, but it's a possibility that it's legitimate to ask, since this, now we don't know what is the... I mean, one possibility is that there is new physics that they, close to the intermediate scale, which could be, again, supersymmetry, could be something else. All the questions could be addressed, and they have an answer with a new scale at the intermediate energy. So that one could not exclude this, this possibility. Actually, going to the same direction with supersymmetry is that if the weak scale is tuned, one possibility could be the split supersymmetry. In other words, that it's not high energy supersymmetry, that all the superpartners are heavy, but only scalars are heavy, and the fermionic superpartners are light, such as the Gaijinos and the Higgsinos. There is a reason for that. The fermionic superpartners carry R charge, carries R symmetry. And in principle, even within supersymmetry, there are two R symmetries and independent symmetry of supersymmetry. So in principle, there is no reason why the scale of the two scales of breaking should be the same. I mean, okay, so could be the supersymmetry scale is higher and the R symmetry breaking is lower, and this protects the mass of the Gaijinos and the Higgsinos to be light. Physically, what one gains is that in this way one maintains the good properties of supersymmetry, which is the Gates coupling unification, which is based only on the fermion contact, and the candidate of the dark matter, which is a combination of Higgsino and Gaijino. But one gets rid of problems such as flavor change in neutral current, since the scalars are heavy. Extra sources of CP violation, and so on. On the other hand, yeah, we can make the same study of the stability and find the allowed value of, take into account the allowed value of the Higgs mass. One finds the split in that case would be moderate, and that's again from analysis of Strumia. So split supersymmetry is there, and one sees that the scale of supersymmetry breaking should be quite low in order, again, to be taking into account the Higgs mass in order for the vacuum to be stable. Even this is also related to the question, the high-scale supersymmetry where everything is heavy. Again, okay, it can go up to the intermediate scale. Everything which is below, of course, is allowed. So it could be very well that in this context, the scalar masses could be a few thousand TeV, and the Gaijinos could be a loop factor lighter than the scalars, and this actually, there were models of this type that could provide, from the point of view of phenomenological, a viable theory. Of course, one doesn't solve the fine-tuning problem. There is some amount of fine-tuning, of course, there's not so much here, but still there's a lot. Also, from the point of view of string theory, this split supersymmetry is a natural context to obtain it in the context of, in the framework of intersecting brains, since the brain stacks by themselves are supersymmetric, and therefore Gaijinos are massless to begin with, while intersections have chiral fermions, but if they are arbitrary, then the supersymmetry is broken at a high scale, and the scalars are massive. So, for the Higgsino, of course, one has to impose that in order to have to guarantee that one has light Higgsino, to impose a condition that the Higgs comes from the supersymmetric intersection, locally supersymmetric intersection. Now, an alternative answer that is one possibility. Another possibility is to insist. Go back to the hierarchy. Of course, one possibility is still to have low energy supersymmetry. We will know, I hope, relatively soon if there is a signal or not. Then there could be other possibilities, such as theories which have low fundamental cutoff, which in the context of string theory means TV strings. Now, the main point that I would like to emphasize here is that in this context, there is no little hierarchy problem in the sense that the electroweak symmetry breaking can occur radiatively, as in the case of supersymmetry, but with no logarithms. In other words, one can imagine a cutoff which is a few TeV, and the Higgs mass to arrive from at a loop level. And then it would be a loop factor times the cutoff square. Of course, in this context, the unification has to be probably dropped. Now, the scheme to realize it, one possibility is with a large extra dimension, and one needs the volume of the transverse volume to be 10 to the 32 in string units. So going back to this electroweak symmetry breaking, one can take a simple toy model in which the Higgs is a massless scalar coming, for instance, from a locally supersymmetric intersection. Therefore, okay, its mass at the tree level is zero, but of course its coupling, its quartic coupling is not zero. And there is a class of models in which this sector arises from a truncation of a supersymmetric theory. In that case, one could obtain even a relation for the quartic coupling to be the same with a supersymmetric relation at the tree level, but it is not a generic. I mean, it can be true or it cannot be true. The main point is that since the theory is not supersymmetric globally, computing the loop corrections, one would find corrections to the Higgs mass parameter in the potential, which will be proportional to the string scale, which is the effective ultraviolet cutoff, times a loop factor. One can make this computation in a simple model in which I kept, just for simplicity, one radius as a parameter. So this is the result of an annulus diagram which one integrates over the length of the annulus. Zero goes to zero is the infrared limit, in which this red factor goes to one, and the result is the same as in like in a field theory, with starting from five dimensions, because I left this radius as a parameter. While at the limit, at the ultraviolet limit, one has the string factor which regulates the ultraviolet divergence. And of course, the integral is finite. And that's how this loop factor depends on the compactification scale. I forgot to mention that the sign can be positive or negative. It can be negative if in this example it was negative, but it depends on the relative weight of fermions versus bosons in the loop. And one can examine these two limits. So the limit r goes to zero is corresponds to, by T duality, to a large transverse dimension. And then this loop factor is what is expected. It's just an ordinary loop factor. On the other hand, when r goes to infinity, so when r is large compared to the string scale, then this radius is ordinary, not transverse, but longitudinal along the brain. And in this example, what happens is that the string scale is replaced, drops off in this limit. And it is replaced by the compactification scale. And the reason for that is that the Higgs scalar in that case becomes a component of a higher dimensional gauge field, and therefore is a higher dimensional gauge invariance which protects protects the quadratic divergences, and that's why the cutoff is the compactification scale. Moreover, the coefficient is calculable in the effective field theory, and one sees that it is much smaller than this one. So that means that it's a particular example in which starting from the electroweak scale, the string scale can be, or the compactification scale can be naturally a few of several TV without having long, so without having a little higher problem. Now the main, of course, the main experimental signal in this this framework is missing energy from the due to gravitational radiation, which has already given bounds up to 4 TeV from the recent LHC results. Concerning the question of black holes, that has been it was also the experimental bounds. In this framework, since the string coupling is perturbative, the black hole mass is two orders of magnitude higher than the string scale, so this is not relevant for in this framework if the string scale is low. And then the question is what other accelerator signatures one could have in this framework. There are three types of other signatures related to the three different scales that they may appear. The first is the string scale, so that's ordinary string resonances that have been analyzed during the last 10 years by a group of Munich and Northeastern. And the experimental bouts already due to this, from this analysis go to 4.5 TeV. Then there is another scale is related to the scale of large TV dimensions, so which could be could correspond to compactification scales lower than the string scale, even in this context. The experimental limits in that case are vary between half and 4 TV, and this depends on how the in these models the fermions are localized. In other words, this is a TV dimension. If the, there are two extreme cases when the quark and leptons are, let's say, twisted states which are completely localized with respect to this dimension, then the experimental bounds are high because these states can be produced in a single way and can give resonances about 4 dB, while the bounds become weaker once some of these fermions start to be propagate also, and therefore the resonances are lost and the experimental bounds become weaker. Finally, the third category of signals has to do with extra U1s, which could acquire masses through anomalies. And the reason is that in that case, the masses are suppressed by a loop factor from the string scale. And therefore, even if the string scale is relatively high, I mean, higher than the, let's say, the reach of the LHC, still there could be low U1s. So this, so let me talk a bit about these extra U1s. These extra U1s could gauge global symmetries of the standard model if they couple to standard model particles. And such global symmetries are baryon and lepton number or the Petz-Quinn symmetry. Actually, the baryon and lepton number, we need to be there if the string scale is low. Now, there are two types of massive U1s. Massive U1s, which are acquired, which have four-dimensional anomalies, and therefore they become massive from the Green-Schwarz mechanism in four dimensions. And massive U1s, which are non-anomalous in four dimensions, but still they can acquire masses related to six-dimensional anomalies. And actually, that could arrive in the hypercharge, and one has to impose a particular condition, a topological condition, which guarantees that the hypercharge, for instance, does not acquire such a mass. The, in general, the masses of non-anomalous U1s that are generated by six-dimensional anomalies are higher than the masses of anomalous of four-dimensional anomalous U1. This is simply because there is an additional volume related to the volume along from six to four dimensions. So one could take a particular example that has the, in addition to the standard model, just the two extra U1s, which are gauged in the, at the string level, which correspond to the baryon and lepton number. This could be generated by this stack of four brains, which means this model has been explicitly derived by orbifolds from the group of Madrid, and also from n equal 2 super by tensor in n equal 2 super hollow models by the group of Seligans. And so it contains the strong interactions, the U3. There is an extra U1 here, which is the baryon number. The weak interactions, which can be SP1, and therefore SU2, and gets rich in this way and does not have an extra U1 here. And then there are two extra U1 brains. One is the lepton number, and the other is the right-handed U1, in other words, the U1 which has the quantum numbers of the third generation of the SU2 right. So there are three U1s. One combination is a hypercharge, and the other two are the baryon and the lepton number, which both are anomalous and acquire masses. And if the string scale is low, both the global symmetries remain in perturbation theory, as we know in oriental constructions, and this is important to guarantee on one hand proton stability, on the other hand small neutrino masses from the, for instance, the appearance of the Weinberg operator LLHH. Now the important consequence here is that if, let's say, B minus L, if there is a right-hand neutrino such that the B minus L is anomaly free in four dimensions, but still it can be massive due to six-dimensional anomalous, then this B minus L is heavier, and the lightest one is a U1, which is almost the baryon number, and which therefore has does not couple to leptons, and this could lead to events of the type that have been claimed to be observed in Tevatron in the CDF. D0 doesn't see, but there's still a debate whether such events exist or not. Now, taking this model, it will be interesting to examine another possibility, the same model, use it for the case where the string scale is high. So you can take the, you can study what happens when you take this model and you push the string scale from TeV to high energies. Then, in that case, the anomalous U1, of course, is super heavy, so I can forget about. However, the non-anomalous one, which is the combination of B minus L and the hypercharge, one could impose a condition that it remains massless at the string level. And in that case, one needs to introduce an extra Higgs with a quantum numbers of the right-hand neutrino in order to break it, let's say, at the TV range. And this would be an extra U1 in the low energy theory. So I could study the effect of this this extra U1. Actually, take into account that there is a U3 unification, in other words, that the SU3 comes with together with a baryon number, and therefore this, the U1B has the same gauge coupling as the SU3. There are two parameters, one coupling and the mass of this extra U1. This one coupling can be chosen to be the coupling of, let's say, the right-handed U1. And imposing perturbativity the, and the unitarity, is the one finds that this range for the coupling of the U1. On the other hand, the present LHC limits are about 3 to 4 TV. And one can study the phenomenology of this model, which is it's quite interesting. So let me be a bit more explicit. One can start from the string basis, and one can go to the low energy basis, where you have, as I mentioned, an extra U1, which I call Y double prime, which is linear combination of B minus L and the U1 right. And the discovery potential for this extra U1 is up to about 5-6 dV for the LHC. On the other hand, there have been recent, it is important for that, that there are three extra right-hand neutrinos to make the B minus L anomaly free. Now, there has been recent cosmological observations that indicate that there is an extra relativistic component in the universe, which is called dark radiation. And this could be parameterized effectively by an effective number of neutrino close to 4. One could use this, since these right-hand neutrinos interact with the standard model fermions via the extra U1, it turns out that their decoupling arises around the quark hadron transition, and one can impose the condition that these right-hand neutrinos could parameterize effectively the dark radiation which is observed in the universe, and this implies a mass range for the extra U1, which is in a region which can be reached at LHC. So that is one interesting result. So this is how this extra U1 varies between, which is a combination of B minus L and UNR, varies in the two limits, in the allowed range of this parameter, which is the coupling of the U1. In one limit, it becomes B minus L, in the other limit, it becomes almost UNR. One can then proceed and do a stability analysis of this model, even in the non-supersymmetric case. So one has the Higgs, in addition to the standard model Higgs, one has another Higgs that has the quantum numbers of the right-hand neutrino, which breaks the extra U1 symmetry. And by studying, imposing the stability condition of the potential, one can explore the parameters now in the Higgs potential, which are again two parameters. One is a mixing, Higgs mixing angle between the two Higgses, and the other is the mass of the second Higgs. And it turns out that there is a region in which this model becomes stable. In other words, by extending the standard model with an extra U1, which is actually B minus L plus linear combination with hypercharging principle, one can avoid the problem of stability of that I showed you before. And okay, these are just some curves with some particular values. So that's, here I took for simplicity the mass of the Z double prime 4.5 dV. I varied the string scale, and here is the allowed parameter for the for the mass of the extra Higgs. Yeah. Okay. So let me just in the last part discuss the linear dilaton background. That's a different actually way to impose that the string scale is low, not by introducing extra dimensions, but by playing with a string coupling, which is equivalent to use the string part to the multiplicity of string excitations in order to understand the lowering of the the effective gravity scale. So it's essentially a theory in which the string coupling is very small, 10 to the minus 16, which determines the hierarchy. And the standard model has to be embedded on NS5 brains and not on D brains, because on D brains, the string coupling is related to the gauge coupling, and one cannot realize this situation consistently. So one can study this theory using gauge gravity duality. When one has D3 brains, then the near horizon geometry, we know that it's ADS5. While for NS5 brains, one obtains the near horizon geometry, which is a linear dilaton background in a four-dimensional flat string frame metric. So why is the extra coordinate? Now I can based on this observation, I can take a toy model starting from a five-dimensional theory, effective field theory, that has, in addition to gravity, the dilaton, and introducing two boundaries. So take the extra coordinate to be on a line segment, and introducing the two boundaries, brains, which can be NS5 brains or D brains, depending on this dilaton factor, which doesn't play a role in the analysis. Now, this theory has, this five-dimensional theory has two solutions. One solution is constant dilaton and added the Sitter metric. Yeah, I forgot to say that I added a cosmological constant, which is actually a three-level cosmological constant, which is a dilaton potential, a runaway dilaton potential. So this one solution is the RS actually model, because the bulk metric is ADS, and the dilaton is constant, and this is okay. We know what are the consequences of this model. The other solution is a flat metric, a sigma model metric, and the dilaton linear in this in the extra coordinate. In that case, the hierarchy is due to the fact that the string coupling varies exponentially with the extra coordinate, and therefore the Planck scale can be much larger because of this exponential hierarchy. In this toy model, one can study the excitations around this background of the graviton, for instance. One finds that the four-dimensional zero mode, so graviton, is flat, while the Kaluza-Klein gravitons have a profile which are localized near the standard model. So here I take the standard model to be at the origin, and on the other side you have the Planck brain, if you want. So the Kaluza-Klein modes lie here, and they have a spectrum which is like a toroidal spectrum, determined with a radius which is the size of the length of the interval, but there is a mass gap which is determined by the coefficient of the linear dilaton background. So this imposing the hierarchy, one finds that this alpha is much. If you take it for instance one TV, then this length has to be a bit smaller, so that because in the hierarchy, if you want, you have an exponential because of this exponential. And one finds that the spacing is much, the spacing of the Kaluza-Klein excitations is much smaller than the mass gap, which means that if you take the mass gap to be at 1 TeV, the spacing is about 30 GeV, so there should be a quasi-continuum of a very dense spectrum of Kaluza-Klein modes, each one coupled with an extra suppression factor, the same suppression factor, compared to the five-dimensional effective Planck scale. Now, this is an interesting realization that extrapolates actually between the RS model and the flat extra dimensions for the for the n equal 1 case. If in other words, for just one, this model is viable even in the case of one extra dimension, because precisely one does not have the experimental bounds that constraints that one has in the case of flat extra dimension due to the fact that there is this mass gap. And therefore, there are distinct experimental signals. So I guess my time is over. So to conclude from the beginning, or the first part of the talk, the conclusion is that the possible discovery of the Higgs scalar, the LHC, is a big step forward, I think. There is a primary importance to measure the string coupling, the Higgs couplings, and identify if you want that this particle is the Higgs of the standard model or not. And this could give, on the other hand, a hint on the origin of the mass hierarchy in the physics beyond the standard model. So some of the questions we'd like to ask is if the supersymmetry is there, if it is natural or unnatural, if, for instance, there is no supersymmetry, if there is lost in scale in some realization, or something new and unexpected. Thank you.
Actually, I have two questions. The first one, I think to this point, still the most attractive scenario phenomenologically might still be the heterotic M theory with the largish extra dimension, so that you bring down the Planck scale to the gut scale, and that seems compatible with what we know. Would you agree with that?
Yeah. I mean, this is what I said from the beginning. That
I thought you were saying that the heterotic scale you were saying was at 10 to the 19 or 18.
And, I mean, this is what I said, that the low energy supersymmetry can be realized. The natural framework of string theory is the heterotic string in the either perturbative or non-perturbative version.
Okay.
I mean, simply I want to say that the intersecting brains It's not natural in the sense in this context because in general do not guarantee unification. While the heterotics thing or the M theory guarantees unification.
The framework that Witten and I proposed in, what was it, 96, I think, where you have this larger fifth dimension and just the gut scale going down to the, the Planck scale to the gut scale. That seems like it's a viable.
Yeah, that's still viable. Okay. If you want, the problem with this is not, I mean, it's not at the question of the string, it's the question of the low energy supersymmetry, that it has to do with this fine-tuning problem, little fine-tuning problem that started already to be worrisome, at least when the extension of the supersymmetric extension of the standard model is the MSSM, the minimal version.
Right. My more technical question, you mentioned that the large N trick for reducing the Planck scale, and you were posing an NS5 scenario where you were saying the string scale would be string coupling would be 10 to the minus 16.
Yeah.
Do you know some mechanism that would pick out that particular small value, or is that dialed by hand 10 to the minus 16 for the string coupling?
I mean, this model has a lot of similarities with the Radner-Sundermann model, so one can invent a mechanism like the Goldberg Weiss mechanism. That again stabilizes this.
So would that pick out a small value like that?
Yeah, you can do it. You can do the same game. Okay. At the level of the toy model, of course, of the five dimensions.
Well, once you pick up one of your model, you also have to see if the cosmology makes sense. Because we also have other precision data that come from the CMB that favor very strong the inflationary phase. So you also should put that as a constraint in your models, right?
Yeah, okay.
And because here it seems
you have some particular proposal. There are no, I agree that there are data from cosmology, but they are not so much constrained for the moment.
Give or take, you know. These are not much more constrained either. But if you take those into account, can you rule out some from the zoo?